Welcome to Footy SA and WA, thanks to OTR Making Life Easy. Well, the horrible season that was finishes for the Adelaide Crows. And can West Coast get their best side together to make a serious tilt at a grand final? Kane, it's going to be very interesting now as the teams start to shape up for the big stuff.
Finals are locked in, Scotty. Yeah, it's going to be a really exciting final series. Of course, Port Adelaide in the thick of it, as are West Coast with that home final that they've qualified for. So they'll win through to that. I guess the challenge for them is how they go outside of Western Australia and how many numbers on that injured list that they can get back.
Straight into the Dometic news headlines. Keep things cool with the Dometic CI42 Icebox. It was going to be an interesting year for Fremantle with a new coach and obviously a list that was building. And I think it's a tick for Justin Longmuir. A pretty impressive start to his coaching down at the Port town.
He's got the goods, I think, Justin Longmuir. So he's got, I really like his temperament. He's clearly got a good rapport with his players. He's not afraid to make a big call as well, as we've seen the way that he's used Fife and Walters this year as Fife just kicks a bomb from outside 50. Those two spent more time forward and he's really prioritised youth. So he's got a sound game plan. He clearly knows what he's doing defensively. Yep. And offensively, I think it's a work in progress. But they've exceeded my expectations and there's nothing to say with some pieces that they could move around in the off-season that they are well on their way to returning to finals sooner rather than later. So them and Sydney, I think, are the teams most likely to possibly play finals that have missed the eight this year. I'm just not sure about Melbourne, Carlton and Essendon. Their credentials moving forward, and of course Adelaide and Gold Coast still seem a fair way off it.
I agree. What I've liked most about his coaching is he's been prepared to throw some of the senior players and the established players into some different roles. Fife's played a little bit more forward. Obviously Mundy's been in some different roles, and Walters as well. It's been great coaching, I think, in his first season.
No doubt. As I said, he's prioritised youth, which is good, but he's still rewarded performance. So I think when you've got a rebuilding side, the easiest thing is to do just to discard the players that are sort of above the age of 27, 28. He hasn't done that at all. He's really rewarded form and there's been some integrity at selection, which I like. So, as I said, I'm fascinated to see what they do with Jesse Hogan. Still a little bit of footy left in him, but he's out of favour, clearly still contracted. So can they get an offer for him that is enticing for them? Because I think ideally they would like to move him out. And we've spoken about their backline at length and the injuries that they've suffered down there with Logue and Pierce and these players that have missed a lot of footy. So get those guys back in, then all of a sudden the spine looks really good with Taberner now a legitimate key target in the forward line.
Where do you think Hogan should go? If he was going to go somewhere else, which side do you think should make a big play for him? I don't think he should go personally. I'd hold him. But if he had to go, who would take him?
I think they've made the decision, by the way, that they have overlooked him at selection this year. It's a good year to be a key forward, though. There's probably four clubs that I could think need a key forward. Melbourne are desperate for one. If you look at their key forwards that haven't been able to do anything, but of course Hogan was there, so unlikely he would return to Melbourne. I think Essendon, particularly if Joe Danaher leaves, there's some pieces and some shuffling around. I think Brisbane are keen for a key forward to support McStay and Hipwood. That's why they've been linked to Danaher. So look, there's three or four clubs that I could see Hogan landing at. It's ironic though that the club that he left, Melbourne, probably in most desperate need of a key forward.
Now, Kane, there's a lot of conspiracy theories floating around just in general at the moment. Surely Caleb Sarong takes out the Rising Star. Surely there's no way that it goes anywhere else.
I don't know if it will fall this way. I think Noah Anderson is going to win it. But if I could take my pick of who I would want out of the pool, I would go for Sarong. I think what is underrated about him, and we'll see a little bit of it here, is how tough he is. Like, he's not big, is he, midfielder at all, but he's such a clean ball user and he makes good decisions. And when the footy's there to be won, he wins it. So he reminds me a little bit of Lachie Neale. Like, he's got that Lachie Neale type body. He's got a bit more explosiveness than Neale, but I don't think he'll win it, unfortunately, because he came in late. I think Noah Anderson's body of work will see that he'll get the votes. But Sarong would be the player that I'd pick out of the group.
He's a ball of power, isn't he? He's very hard to tackle. When they put that first tackle on him, he sort of shrugs it and he's able to get the ball clear. I think he's got a great career in front of him and I hope he wins it. I think he's had an amazing season. Eagles, they're in the mix, but they are just battling to get their best side back on the park. It was a gutsy win over the Roos. Expected to win, but it was a very slow start.
Yeah, it was. It wasn't one for the highlights, real. In fact, I switched off at halftime, which I don't often do. I switched it on to binge, Scotty. There was something that was more enticing than this game of footy. It was pretty ordinary. Adam Simpson spoke about how slippery the conditions were But how good's that guy going? Flying Ryan. Like, he's one of the most watchable players in the game now. And if it wasn't for him and Nat Nui on this Thursday night game, I'm not sure they would have got over the line against North Melbourne. I've still got a bit of faith in the Eagles. A lot of people have written them off due to their away record away from Perth, but they win their first home final. That's a given, so lock that in. And then all they have to do is win three more in a row to win a pretty remarkable premiership. They won eight in a row at stages through the year, so they've only got to do half that. I think they can cause some real trouble in the finals, particularly if they get some of those players back. Bit nervous about Elliot Yeo. Not sure how much footy he will play, but Shuey and some others coming back in will be a big boost. And the bye before the finals this week clearly helps them.
I think one thing, I mean, this side has played 6 years of finals footy. Oh, I just think they're hardened. That's an expectation at West Coast that they play finals and they go deep into finals. So I think we'll see some of their senior players that rise. The energy to Kennedy. Look, we know what a spiritual leader he is at that club. How significant is this one?
I think he'll be okay. Like, it's just, you see there, rolled ankle. It was the inside, which is a bit worse. It's usually a bit sorer than the outside. But with the week off and the way that they managed him with caution, he didn't play any further part in that game, was a smart option, clearly. So even if he has to get a little local anaesthetic in that ankle, it's one of those ones that you can numb the pain. And he's been a warrior. He's been battered. He's been bruised. Can't remember a season he's played without some sort of ailment. But he'll be right. He'll be there for that first final, and I'd expect him to kick three or four.
Are they making up the numbers, Kane? I mean, McGovern, Shuey, Redden, I'm just reading through the list here, Cripps, Jetta. Are there too many wounded soldiers?
Nah. I think they'll do some damage. I think they'll cause some issues for some hardened, experienced final side. So, as I said, if it wasn't for that week off and their ability to go home, then, yeah, you'd probably question it. But they'll get a boost by going home. They'll have this week off. They'll get some of those numbers back you mentioned. Not all, but some of them. And then another week, because they'll win that. So in, you know, 3 weeks' time, you'd expect some of those names to come back for the second week of the finals, which they will progress through to.
Crows v Tigers. There were some glimpses early. They missed some chances early. Crows' inaccuracy was costly and Richmond were just shooting the lights out. Just looking at the last month, have you liked the improvement? I know this game ends up, they're out of their depth against a side that could win the premiership, but just some glimmers of hope over the last month?
I have. I was here live and watching this. There's some areas of the game that I like, and their last five games have been strong. This was a bit of a letdown and probably, you know, reflective of the difference between the two sides, no doubt about that. But look, they've got some positives to work into the season. It's the most important off-season the Adelaide Football Club has ever had. So they'll get two, as it sits right now, top 10 draft picks. If Brad Crouch leaves, which I assume he will, there's a possibility that they get three top 10 draft picks. And that's the best draft hand they've ever had. But I want to, you know, put the pressure on some of the players that have been there for a while. Chase Jones will be entering his third preseason. Ned McHenry, both first-round draft picks. Darcy Fogarty coming into his fourth preseason. Not fit enough, Darcy Fogarty. We've seen it. And he's got the results this year. So those three high draft picks that have now been in the system for 3 and 4 seasons need a massive preseason. Otherwise, it doesn't matter how many picks Adelaide have got. The improvement's got to come from the 22, 23-year-olds at the Adelaide Football Club. And then the senior players got to come along for the ride, which they have done in the back half of the year. So Laird and Lynch and O'Brien's been great in the ruck. Some others, Brody Smith, they'll get Miller back, they'll get Duday back. Sloan's got a lift. And then all of a sudden, it's not as doom and gloom, but a bitterly disappointing season, all in all, that goes without saying.
Oh, it's their worst season in the club's history. Fogarty and Himmelberg, have they shown enough to give you that real optimism about their key forward targets, or do they need to go into the draft and grab another one?
Himmelberg has shown enough. I think there's definitely enough there to think, well, hang on, he can hold down a key position spot for the next 4 or 5 years. Fogarty hasn't, though. Nothing I've seen from Darcy Fogarty, apart from his one trick that he's got, and that's just to lead out, take a mark and turn around and kick a goal.
Yep.
What is Darcy Fogarty's point of difference to the other key forwards in the game? What is going to have him having some longevity in the game? Is it agility? No. Is it breakaway speed? No, it's not. Is it a big tank that allows him to go in the midfield? No, it's not. So he's got to come up with something, and I would think he needs to have a chat to Christian Petrarca or some others that have completely turned their body shape around. He's got to spend some more time in the midfield. So it's got to be more like De Goey, and that's the style of footy he's got to be.
Yep.
Play forward. If it doesn't work for you, you've got to be able to go on ball, spend 10 minutes there, a quarter, get into the game, and then go back and be a goal-kicking forward. So no doubt, as I said, a massive pre-season coming up for Darcy Fogarty because his career is genuinely at the crossroads.
Yeah, he needs to look at someone like a Kennedy from West Coast who just works so, so hard. And again, Kennedy's not that explosive, but gee, he worked them over in his prime as a player. We mentioned this player last week and I thought he took another jump again, Scholl. I want you to have a look at this bit of footage here. He is really starting to show some signs of not just emerging, but he could be a real A-grader.
Left and right, and there was a bit of controversy that he missed out on the Rising Star last week after getting the 8 coaches' votes. You'd expect he gets it this round. But, yeah, his ball use on both sides. They rate him as the best kick at the club already, so he's only played 8 games. So big, big future for him. I think he's got to get a bit bigger and a bit stronger, and that will happen once he gets in the weights room because as a defender, you still have to be able to defend, and at times he's looked all at sea in the one-on-one contest, but when he gets the footy in his hands, it's perfect. They got a lot of foot soldiers down back, the Crows, Brown, Hardigan, McAsee, Kelly, Hardigan, I said. So players that have some flair are worth their weight in gold for Adelaide.
Just before we go to the break, do they target mids, forwards or defenders? What do they need most importantly?
All of the above, but I think if Brad Crouch leaves, it's got to be midfield, doesn't it? There's been some of their midfield numbers this year have been really poor. So someone with a bit of speed through the midfield can play a bit more hybrid, so inside, outside, good ball user, but they don't grow on trees. So do you target it in the draft or do you target it from another club? And then what's the attraction for an experienced player to come to Adelaide for a side that's completely rebuilding? So they're all the decisions that have been made right now. I think they've got to be a bit more ruthless with Brad Crouch, though. Matthew Nicks spoke after the game that he's going to give him 2 weeks to make up his mind on his future. Why 2 weeks? He's had all year. If I'm Matthew Nicks, I say, Brad, by the close of business on Wednesday, tell me if you want to play for the Adelaide Football Club. There's our offer. You either take it or you express your right to free agency. I wouldn't be giving him 2 weeks because Adelaide have got to get a move on and they've got to make some decisions really quickly about their list, and Brad's holding that up.
Agreed. Time to get serious at the Adelaide Crows. Massive summer ahead for some of those Crows players. After the break, the OTR takeaway. Stay with us. Great to have you with us. You're watching Footy SA and WA. Thanks to OTR making life easy. The OTR takeaway this week, get a yummy Moe's Violet Crumble Shake at OTR. Get it for a limited time only, so get in quick. Big, big end of the season, as we've mentioned with regards to the Adelaide Crows. Let's have a look at this board here, Kane. Let's get definitive, because there's got to be a shakeout from the worst season in the club's history. Who are the definites? Who are the absolute keeps? I know you touched on some previously, but let's name them.
Well, there's not many on the list, and I'm speculating, and I expect most of these players would have been told today or tomorrow their exit meeting what the future lies. If it was me, I would keep McKay. I think he has done enough. He's not going to cost you much. You know, he's a model citizen. He plays whatever role he's needed to, and he's had a solid year. So I'd extend his career, and 250 games in sight for him. I think Ben Keyes has done enough. I'd like to see him get another year. He's played the majority of the games, and every time he has played, he's given tremendous effort. And I'd keep Hardigan as well, because I think he's a solid citizen down back. Probably not in your first choice if some of these youngsters progress, but a handy backup. And other than that, I think the rest are probably gone. Obviously, you'd like to keep Brad Crouch, but I think the writing's on the wall there. So, yeah, some massive changes. On the back of them making 10 changes last year to their list, they've already lost Atkins. So it's probably going to be upwards of 10 again. And in the space of 2 seasons, you've basically turned over 50% of your list.
What about a top 20 pick in Jordan Gallucci? 2016, he was pick number 15. It's hard to throw away those top 20 picks. They're so valuable. Not worth persevering?
I don't think they will. I think they'll move on from him. Now, he may get a home somewhere else, but it's a pick that's going to really hurt them, because in this draft, it was a really strong draft. Now, they had pick 15, as you're seeing on the screen there. They went for Gallucci. They could have had Sam Powell-Pepper from Port Adelaide, Todd Marshall from Port Adelaide. They could have got Jared Berry, who's, you know, a top 10 player at the Brisbane Lions, midfielder that they need. And they also could have got Tim English. And there's another one in Will Haywood as well. So 5 players that went after Jordan Gallucci that they could have taken, including a South Australian in Haywood, that if they had picked, would be inside the Crows' top 10 players now. So that's how important the draft is. So it's all good to have these picks that Adelaide are going to get, but it means nothing if you don't get the pick right, as they didn't with Jordan Gallucci, unfortunately.
There was a lot of interest in him at the time. Do you think he's got any value at the trade table, or is this going to be a straight D-list?
I think he'll be delisted, but it's not to say some other club won't make another go on him. He's a Victorian lad. He's had a ruptured Achilles this year, so hasn't played any footy, so they haven't had a chance to have a good look at him. Look, I've seen him kick 4 goals in a game and have 20 disposals, but he just hasn't done enough. And so I'm not sure why it hasn't progressed like it was and why his development has stagnated. And now he's got that really significant 12-month injury, which makes it really hard.
Big fallout at the end of the season, as we've mentioned a few times already here today. After the break, two amazing games of footy from yesteryear in Kia's Great State Moments. Don't miss these, they are brilliant. This is Footy SAWA, thanks to OTR's barista-made sea coffee. Kia Great State Moments, brought to you by Kia's 7-year warranty. Kia offers value you can trust and Australia's best 7-year warranty across the entire Kia range. We've spoken about the improvement in Fremantle this year, and Justin Longmuir has really started to usher in some new players. But it was their defence that was so impressive. They really elevated themselves and gone from being average. You see them ranked, you know, 9th, 9th and 9th in all the key defensive. So they took a big jump, Kane.
Pretty good numbers, isn't it? Mm. Really solid numbers. And that's what you often hear. New coaches that come in, they want to work on the defensive action. They don't often speak about the offence. They think that will come. Matthew Nix tried to do the same in Adelaide. Didn't work. So credit to Justin for being able to do this. Look at these numbers. Number one for Oppo scores per inside 51 in another area of categories. And when they have turned the footy over, they've been so good to get back and support their defence. As you can see there, opposition goals per inside 50 is a percentage, and in general, points against is a pretty good indication of where you sit amongst it. Look, I think that offensive stuff will come, get some personnel back. Michael Walters didn't have his best year, and he missed some games through the injury, of course. So they're in a really good position, as we've spoken about throughout the night.
To win grand finals, you have to be pretty much top four, both defensively and offensively. So it's not hard to know where their focus is going to be over the summer. I think some of that will come from their emerging midfield. We saw younger players coming into that midfield this year and have some really impressive game time. Have a look here. This is under 20 years of age, and Brayshaw, Chira and Sarong. You know, that's the top 10 in the competition, and they've got 3 of them.
And when you get those picks, it's why it's so important to pick the right guys. And they've done that with Brayshaw, you know, pick 2 from a few years ago, of course. And, you know, we're seeing Chera here and Sarong we've spoken about. Some others also coming through as well. And Henry, I like, is a small forward. I think he'll be electric at some point throughout his career, and that should happen soon. So, yeah, the ability to give them game time, centre bounce minutes, paid massive dividends, and these three could form a pretty formidable combination for the next 7 to 8 years.
Can you see Walters spending a little bit more time midfield again next year? And just, I mean, you're looking at trying to increase some offence and some real creativity through the middle. Could his role become a little bit more offensive focus through the middle?
It's almost game to game, isn't it, with Walters? I think if you are elite in one area, then that's where you should spend the most of your time. He's the elite small forward of the competition, so I'd be spending most of the time there, particularly when, as we know, they've struggled offensively. So that's where I'd go into the season thinking he's going to play most of his footy. Doesn't mean he doesn't have, you know, 20 minutes a game in the midfield, but I think he's just a genuine star as a forward, capable of kicking 40-plus next year.
Final rating for Fremantle in 2020?
Out of 10, yeah, I'd give them a 6, wouldn't you? I think, you know, exceeded my expectations.
Yeah, I think we had them about 3s at the start of the year, though, so they've certainly gone a long way past that. Kia Great State League Moments. This is magnificent, this one right here. 1981, South Fremantle taking on Claremont in a grand final. And just watch this. This is the opening bounce coming off the right-hand side here in a moment. Basil Campbell with a bicycle helmet that was unbelievable. And this was on. This is the Cracker Brothers. This is Bruce Monteith. It was also the Richmond captain after that. Morris Rioli was right in the mix there. Some serious pugilists and a lot of talent in that mix. It was an amazing game, Kane.
Bring back the bike helmet. That is amazing. And I'm going to go back to 1975 to a ground that is really special to me. This is the Bay Oval. Look how packed it is. That's Peter Marker. This is a Glenelg side who scored 317 points. There's
what?
My old man, Freddie Phyllis, Peter Carey. He played over 400 games in the Sandville. It's Fred Phyllis. He kicked 18, if you don't mind. You don't see bags of 18 like that, and that was his 100th for the year, so the crowd at the Glenelg Oval run out. This is footy at its purest and at its best. That's Snout McFarlane there, Scotty, with a chance to kick Glenelg's 50th goal but he hits the post on the siren, and you can see the score there, 49-23.
So you would have dropped him. You would have dropped Snout. You know, they've only kicked 49 goals. He's missed the 50th. He's out. He's out.
I see him all the time at my local supermarket just down at Glenelg, and he's never been able to live it down, Snout McFarlane. He's an absolute ripper. But what a powerhouse the Glenelg Footy Club was back in the day.
49 goals, 23, 317. That is phenomenal. After the break, the Lumo list. Stay with us. It's been great to have you with us. You're watching Footy SAWA. Thanks to OTR's Barista Made Coffee. You're watching the Lumo Energy SA list right now. And it starts with a big man showing us his talent. You like this one, Kane. Big Darcy. They're calling him Mr. Darcy now, out of respect.
Yeah, well, he's been in Aaron Sandilands' shadow for a few years. I think he's potentially a number one for the next 5 years. So Fremantle found one, particularly if he can go do that and show his size and his strength. And Jack Darling, your boy, just getting it to turn from the boundary line, Scotty.
Got to marvel at the skills of the player. I mean, 15, 20 years ago, that would have been goal of the week. That's just another goal now. You know, big player, great skills, measured it, lovely. Winding back the clock here, Big Tex. That's a great hanger. And, well, hopefully not his last game. Time will tell, but serious mark. And he created a bit of history after this, Kane.
Well, he did. He went back in the first quarter, got this out the road, so now holds the Adelaide goal-kicking record, overtook Tony Modra. 441 goals, I mean, he's the all-time. What a record to have. I've had Eddie Betts and Modra, and you know, Mark Rusciuto kicked a lot of goals, but Tex at the top of the tree there. So a lovely record for him to finish the season on a positive note.
Yep, some big, big names on that list. As we wrap up, gee, a lot of noise around Travis Boak potentially winning a Brownlow. He's had a great season. Is it good enough to win?
Maybe his last couple of games might hurt him, and Lachie Neal's been good. So proven vote getter though, Boakey. So I reckon it's out of Boakey and Neal. I expect Lachie Neal maybe just.
And we had our favourites, I guess, the Geelongs and the Richmonds. Western Bulldogs, all of a sudden, could they have a repeat of their premiership year?
I don't think so. I think anyone outside the top four will be West Coast that could do it.
Well, we're going to find out pretty soon. We're getting right to the heavy stuff right now. Thanks for joining us on Footy SAWA.